Hi all, welcome to the last session of today. We are in a different environment now. We are not at home. We are actually in a Badelman studio. It's a studio very close to ASML. And we will broadcast the rest of this Pi Data event from this studio. So we had arranged this that studio so that our speakers will come here to give their presentations from here, and we would have a small audience also here and to broadcast from here. Nevertheless, due to most recent developments of COVID, we decided to allow the speakers to decide by themselves if they want to come to the studio or not. So the as a result, we have this type of hybrid event that some speakers presented from home, and some of the event had been hosted from home, while the rest of the event will take place from that studio the coming days till Friday. So let me give a short introduction, basically, of who I am and the host here. So I am Dimitra, and I will be the host. My co-host here in that studio will be Wouter as well. And we have our invisible hero, Dennis, for the rest of the day, co-hosting the event and helping with the Zoom administration. You can always ask your questions via Zoom Q&A. We will keep also an eye on Discord, but it's always more convenient for the talk to ask what you want to ask in Zoom. Our presenters will be available to Discord after the presentation to answer questions that might have been unanswered. So our first speaker for today is Dana De Brown, who is a lead data scientist at PacMed, and he is going basically to do a very relevant presentation today. He is presenting on how he and his team enabled research, large-scale research for COVID treatment at UMC Amsterdam. So, and he's also going to present about his collaboration with doctors towards this end. So I will give the floor to Dan, and looking forward for the interesting presentation.
Thank you. Yes, I'm Dan, lead data scientist at PacMed. My talk will be about fighting COVID with Python and the challenges and machine learning opportunities there are when you're building a national COVID ICU database, which we have done in the past past months. This talk will be of two parts. First, about how did we build this national COVID ICU database? Secondly, about how can machine learning help fight COVID. I hope to share with you some lessons, what we learned by doing this, and also inspire you with what machine learning can do in healthcare. As an introduction, the ICU, in the ICU, patients that are in critical conditions are treated. And the ICU is a very data-rich environment. So here you see some of the vital signs, lab values, other types of measurements that are done in the ICU. And for a data scientist, it's a nice place to be. Let's say it like that. Because data is recorded in very very high quality and also in high frequency, and therefore. The ICU is a good starting point for machine learning in healthcare. As PacMed, we've been doing that before COVID, implementing software products that predict what will happen with a patient given all the signals that are in the ICU data. However, then COVID entered the stage. And what was special about COVID? Well, some things. There was, of course, little knowledge about effective treatment because it was a new disease. Individual doctors had and still have, you could say, little experience. In individual hospitals, there's only little data to do research with, because individual hospitals have maybe like 50 or 100 patients in their data, and they have little time to do research because the ICUs were full and are now already getting fuller again. So therefore, a consortium was formed, initiated by the Amsterdam UMC, with the goal to work together to research effective COVID treatment. And this is quite unique that so many hospitals you see in the picture are actually collaborating with each other to together do research. The ambition of this consortium was to transform data of all ICUs in the Netherlands into a standardized database, and then make that database available to hospitals, doctors, researchers, data scientists to do machine learning and statistical research that can benefit the patients in the ICU. And I will tell you about some of the challenges we faced while doing so. This is, of course, very very sensitive data. Therefore, of course, data transfer and data storage is highly secured. We asked for permission from the Dutch Authority for Personal Information. De Autoriteit Persoonsgegevens, the AP, it should say there, and we got permission to do so. Directly identifiable information is removed, and there's an opt-out possibility for patients to also after the ICU stay, they can still say request to be removed from the data. And how did we do it? Well, we started with creating queries, and these are actually SQL queries the ICUs could directly apply to their source system, to the electronic health record system. And the learning here was that actually hospitals were very happy with this, as they could participate with only very little effort. The only thing they had to do is in a couple of places change this query, but then it worked just out of the box, and they could share the data with Amsterdam UMC. So this helped a lot. And we also saw a steady amount of data being delivered until September this year, where we had in total data delivered of around 2,000 patients and more than 35 ICUs in the Netherlands. What were some challenges? Well, yeah, most data was not directly usable. We were always happy to receive data until we opened the data, when there was always something wrong with it. Experts were corrupt, unescaped delimiters were haunting us. Data was missing, like column names missing or certain tables missing. So there was always this little problem with every little data set. And when you multiply that with 35 hospitals that deliver data every week, then this turns out to be a very big problem for our engineers. A learning for us was that we should have been even stricter on exact expert specifications when receiving so many data dumps, because every little problem is multiplied 35 times. Here you see what kind of data we got. So there are three different source systems used by hospitals: Higgs, Epic, and Metavision. And you see, and these are the tables we got per source system. And you see that they are the three different source systems are quite different, and it's a lot of tables. In this way we do make the problem from like 35 different types of data, not three different types of data, because within the hospitals that use Higgs, all the data looks the same. Same for Epic and Metavision. So this was for us essential to do, and this was also a very big learning that the closer you are here to the source of medical data, the more homogeneous hospital data sets are, and the more scalable your machine learning or data pipelines will be in the end. What did we do then with this data? Well, we built an extract transform load ETL pipeline to homogenize this data. So you have to imagine every week hospitals send an updated version of their data, which is a lot of CSV files, through Luigi pipeline. These are transformed, and first standardization is done such that they can be put in a staging database, a PostgreSQL database. And then we apply another pipeline, which is a pre-processing pipeline, which I will tell you more about later. And then it's ingested in the data warehouse, which is made available for external researchers. And it's good to mention that we felt a lot of time pressure when building this. The scale was new for us, so many data sets coming in such a pace. We felt like when the first data set arrived, really like tomorrow we have to have results because now there are so many COVID patients in the ICU, so we're really rushed into building this. This did lead into delays later on when refactoring was needed. Because it didn't scale or because two engineers maybe used different tools. So a learning here was to we could should have done even more designing before building, also in even in a pandemic maybe. Then actually the biggest challenge in this project was that all hospitals have different naming conventions, so there's no information standard used. And in this slide, you see an example, all the different ways we do find the parameter pH in the data. So you see it's been recorded in dozens of different ways. First we try to, in an automated way, map this to a standardized name using some regex expressions. However, we learned that that this led to too many mistakes, so parameters mapped to the wrong thing. We found out that it had to be done manually. So we learned that and after the tedious manual process was needed to do this. So we ended up having these enormous Google Sheets with tens of thousands of rows, every row a parameter we found in a database, and then we manually said this belongs to that category, this belongs to that category, and then we verified that with doctors, and we found out that this is also impossible without the help of ICU experts, for ICU doctors. We only started making quick progress here when they were available again, so when the first wave was coming to an end, more or less. I'm not sure if this plot is visible well, but we were not done at this point, because what we also saw is that hospitals use different units for the same measurement. You see here an example, the distribution of end-tidal CO2, certain parameter. And on the left side, not sure if you see the plot, the distribution, but there's a set of hospitals that use a different unit than the hospitals on the right that use another unit. Yeah. Yeah, so you see actually on the left side, you see another peak, another distribution around five. In a color that's not visible. That's just a hospital that uses a different unit of measurement, and we had to convert that. The problem is it was not always recorded in the data that they did use this unit, so we had to make all of these distributions for all parameters for all hospitals to find out what the right unit was, and again, some manual work there. Okay, then that was done, and then we could go to some more advanced stuff. The coding of advanced medical concepts. What you see here is for one patient some registrations of signals during the ICU, and you see over time, and you see a gap actually at some point. That gap could mean two reasons. One is that patient is being turned off, the mechanical ventilation is being turned off, and this patient is breathing by himself, and then it goes wrong, and the patient again has to go to mechanical ventilation, which is very in the end was a bad decision to put the mechanical ventilation off. Or it could mean that this patient, for example, was transferred, or this patient went for a surgery, or this went in a CT scan and therefore went into a mobile ventilator, of which we don't have the data, and it's not registered in the data well or registered at all when exactly they started and stopped mechanical ventilation. So we had to infer that from other data that was in the database. This is the question, and what we ended up is making this diagrams, this decision rules, together with ICU doctors to code this medical concept. So when is this a real extubation and when is it not? And coded these. And a learning for us is here that data scientists really should have sufficient domain knowledge to be able to work together with ICU doctors on such a problem. So we separate our data science role at PacMed now in a machine learning/data pipeline engineer data scientist, and a medical data scientist who should really have enough knowledge about everything what's happening on the ICU. So you see here the team that was needed, a big team from PACMed, engineers, data scientists, medical experts, but also a very big team of medical experts from Amsterdam UMC and other hospitals in the Netherlands. We succeeded this in the end. We have delivered the data warehouse, made available for academic research, of now comprised of 20 hospitals, 1,300 patients, and more than 50 million measurements of 500 different parameters, all standardized to the right unit and naming. And this data warehouse is made available to academic research or clinical research. So we made a repository with a small API to where they with which researchers can query the data warehouse, and already four different research groups are doing research on this data warehouse. We ourselves, together with Amsterdam UMC, are finishing at this moment a very granular descriptive paper with what we think are new COVID insights about what's really happening with ICU patients when they are admitted, and how patients that survive are different from patients that do not, and will lead, we think, to also to implications for treatment. This is about to be published, and it's the biggest data set of its kind now in the world. At the same time, we are holding webinars where we share insight with the hospitals and where they can ask us questions, what we should look into, and we explain a process and to get this loop going to give back also the insights to the hospitals. Then to the second part of this talk, which might be for PyData even more interesting. So how can machine learning help fight COVID? I wanted to touch upon four different areas in machine learning and four different models that are currently being developed on this COVID data warehouse. The first is interpretable models. Some example modeling questions are: what is the likelihood a patient survives the ICU given the first X days of ICU admission, or what is the likelihood the patient develops specific complication so that I can act early on it? A very reasonable question, for which you can use machine learning. The challenge is there is not really time to implement machine learning models in software solutions with respect to COVID, because this just takes too much time given this crisis. So doctors must act based on guidelines. So here interpretability comes in. And of course, you can use SHEP or LIME to interpret any black box machine learning model. This is an example of such a model, XGBoost model, good performance, but still not really interpretable when not implemented in the software product. So for us, at this point, not really usable. You have, of course, decision trees, which we are also trying on this data warehouse. Those are interpretable if you don't make them too deep. However, we see that the performance is quite a lot lower than of the XGBoost model, though they are very, very interpretable. So we're looking for other methods that are maybe a bit more accurate and still interpretable. And what for us now works quite well, it seems, are Bayesian rule lists. That is basically a machine learning method where rule lists are generated, and rule lists are nothing more than if then else statements. If X and Y, then high risk. If Z, then low risk. And it tries to build the most simple list of rules that is as performs well, as well as possible. There are some hyperparameters you can tune, like the maximum length of the rules, and you get then something like this, which is, in our experiments, performs much better than decision trees and is still very interpretable, maybe even more interpretable than decision trees. Then reinforcement learning. Also, reinforcement learning is applied to the COVID data warehouse. one of the modeling questions that's being worked on by the Foo machine learning group is, what are the settings of the mechanical ventilation that lead to the best outcomes? And why is that challenging? Well, ventilator settings are changed all the time, like every couple of hours. And it's all in the end about the long-term outcome, survival or early discharge. But there's only a subtle relation between these treatment choices and the outcome. So reinforcement learning is a potential technique to go here, because you have a state space, an action space, and a reward. The state is all patient data until the current incurred action, so until the new setting of the ventilator. Then you have the action space. For example, with respect to COVID, that is the FiO2 versus PEEP. So that is O2 means how much oxygen is in the you give to the patient, the percentage of oxygen, and PEEP is the pressure of the oxygen you give to the patient. So how much pressure do you put into the lungs? And both can help the patient, because if it gets more oxygen, then in the end there's more oxygen in the blood, and the patient can improve. And if there's more pressure in the lungs, also the lungs might take up more oxygen. However, if you set either or both of them too high, it can damage the lungs. So it's a continuous balance of not putting this too high to damage the lungs while still making sure the patient has enough oxygen. So this is framed as a reinforcement learning problem, where the reward is both short term, namely oxygen in the blood, and potentially also a negative reward of damaging the lungs. And in the long term, the reward is admission duration or survival. So that's also currently being developed. Then domain adaptation. The modeling question there is what we are working on ourselves. What is the risk a patient is will be re-intubated after being extubated? So that happens quite often, like 10 to 15% of the cases. Doctors think the patient might be well enough to be extubated, so the mechanical ventilation is being turned off. However, the patient worsens and is re-intubated, so again being put on mechanical ventilation. However, we only have around 1,000 intubated patients to learn from, and it is quite unbalanced. Only 10-15% of the patients have this complication. We need more data. Luckily, there are large-scale open-source databases available in the ICU world. You have the Amsterdam-UMC database of data of Amsterdam-UMC patients between 2003 and 2016. And you have, for example, the MIMIC database of 40,000 patients who stayed in Israeli ICU. These are openly available for research. And in these databases, there are also patients that have so-called acute respiratory distress syndrome, ARDS. And these patients have quite similar characteristics as COVID patients. They are different, but they are there's quite some parallels there. So the question is, can we also learn from these patients and improve our COVID model? So how can you do that? Well, we are working on several techniques. First one is simply pooling, adding the ARDS patients to the COVID data. Maybe give more weight to the COVID patients, but train on both. Second, train a model on ARDS data, a sequential model we call it, and then further train this model on the COVID data. You can do this in several ways. You can use the ARDS model as a prior or regularize towards it. If you make a logistic regression, you can use the predictions of the first model and feed it as a feature in the new model. Makes it not very interpretable, but it's an option. Or you can train a neural network or XGBoost on the ARDS data and then continue training this model on the COVID data. And the last one, hierarchical modeling, what we're trying out is that you train only one model, but you allow for general and domain-specific coefficients and try to have as little as possible domain-specific coefficients by regularizing towards a model with regularizing them stronger. So you get a generic model with only some domain-specific coefficients. And the last one I wanted to touch upon was causal inference. Of course, you can imagine that a very relevant question for COVID is which patient should be treated with a certain medication. Or another question, for example, is when should we turn a patient on their belly versus on their back, prone or supine position? So which patient benefits from that in which state? And the problem there in medical data always is confounding, so that doctors do not randomly treat or not treat patients. They do that based on what they think is best. And patients that get treated are different from patients that are not treated. So therefore, we have in medicine, of course, randomized controlled trials. But we still hope, you cannot always do randomized controlled trials for all problems. And we hope to also learn from this data set. And we are working together with Cambridge University on this because, causal models are very tricky and you can make mistakes quickly. So it's important to do this responsibly. And we think the Cambridge University has very good has done very good work on this. For example, a package I wanted to mention is the clairvoyance package. According to Cambridge, a unified end-to-end pipeline for time series data developed to aid clinical research and decision support. And what's I think the nice thing about this pipeline is that it is an AutoML pipeline for medical data, but it also involves advanced treatment effect estimations within the pipeline. I wanted to show what kind of treatment effect models there is. I won't go into much detail, but it's basically there are different methods, and both work in both split up the problem in a first phase where they try to remove the bias from the data. So they try to make the treated and non-treated patients as similar as possible in terms of their features. So in the first, in the paper that's called Deep Treat, it's been done through an autoencoder decoder network. And in the Genite paper, it's done using generative adversarial network. And after that, when the bias is removed by this network, it's feed it into just a supervised classification neural network. And in academic literature, these models perform better than all benchmarks. So we are also hoping to try them out on COVID. What's next? Well, we hope to soon, like in a week or 2 weeks, publish our findings and be of value in the second wave in the Netherlands, but also outside of the Netherlands. We are closer to the Maxima Medical Center, where probably ICUs are getting fuller and fuller. So we feel the pressure to really publish now. And after that, we really hope to continue with this built infrastructure in the post-COVID era to facilitate machine learning-based decision support development in regular ICU care, not only in COVID care. So we can also help use Python to fight not only COVID, but fight other diseases in the ICU and outside of the ICU. That was my presentation, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thanks, Dan, for the very interesting talk. So we have some questions from the audience. The first question is from Ruben. What do you use for hierarchical modeling?
Yeah, so actually we have developed some code ourselves there. It's in the paper I showed you is developed by an intern at TechMed. And it's a good reference. I don't know all the details, but basically it's a Bayesian way of regularizing towards a model with as little as possible domain-specific coefficients and as much as possible generic model. But the paper gives a very good explanation of this. Yeah.
Okay. I also have a question. You mentioned basically that you are doing some root cause findings at the last part of your project. And you mentioned that you're going to use basically some deep learning methods for that. Did you also consider traditional methods for that, Bayesian methods basically for that? Or why do you select those particular methods?
No, definitely. We will also try the more, let's say, mainstream methods. Propensity weighting is, of course, one of the most widely used methods. And it might be that we don't have enough data to train this more advanced methods. I just thought that nice to mention that these developments in machine learning are also with respect to causal models, and because I think it is clear that the usual methods are most of the time not accurate enough to be of value in healthcare. So we need I think it's important to look at the innovations there.
Okay. Thanks. We also have another question on Q&A from Scott. He says that you mentioned variations of medical terminology across hospital. Did you try to make use of any medical terminology standards?
Yeah.
He mentions one standards, SNOMED CT.
Yeah.
Did you try this?
Yeah. No, it's a very good point, and we are currently working on that to map, instead of our own mapping, what we made, to map it to international standards. You have some like SNOMED indeed. You also have Odyssey. And we are working on that at the moment. We felt when we started with this project, we didn't have the time to do that. But now we are mapping our own mapping, let's say, to an international standard. Yeah.
And we have one last question. What kind of profile did you use at the end for the medical data scientists?
Yeah, actually, we have two medical data scientists at PacMed. One is trained as a physicist and then became data scientist, and at PacMed mainly developed also his medical knowledge. So it was someone who just has genuine interest in medicine, who just reads a lot about it, joins doctors on their shifts to learn more about it. So that's, I think, one way to become a medical data scientist. And the other medical data scientist we have at PacMed has done both a medicine and a master's, and also a master's in data science. So it's just someone who's trained in both. Yeah.
Interesting. We have 2 minutes till we pass to the next speaker. So we have time for one last question. You mentioned also some reinforcement learning that you try. Do you think that doctors will trust the output of a reinforcement learning algorithm, or are they open to trust basically data science methods in their decision?
Yeah, that is a good question. There are some earlier reinforcement learning models being published on just other ICU topics, and in general, doctors do find that very interesting. Though, what in healthcare, if you want to have real impact, you should prove that your method works in an RCT. So then, for example, what happens is that the outcomes of that reinforcement learning model are transformed into maybe an improved version of the guidelines, or a proposed improved version of the guidelines, and that is then tested in an RCT. And if that is successful, then doctors are willing to use it. So they need evidence. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I see. Thanks. That's the end of this talk. Thanks very much for the interesting talk and answering all our questions.